Welcome, everyone. This is Professor Rood, and I will begin our lecture on Chapter 10, Crustal Deformation. Let's start by defining what deformation is. This is an overall general term referring to the changes in shape or position of a rock body. And the changes in shape or position is in response to a stress that has been applied. Oftentimes, deformation is associated with plate boundaries. As a result of deformation, we have what are called geologic structures that are formed. And this is what this chapter will look at, the different geologic structures, including folds, faults, joints, foliation, rock cleavage. And let's get started with that. Here we're looking at a picture of folds. In addition to folds, there is a fault running through here. So this deformation in these rocks was caused by compressional stress. The folds forming deeper in the earth where the rock behaves plastically, whereas faulting is a brittle behavior and occurs nearer to the earth's surface. Stress is the force that deforms rocks. When a stress exceeds the strength of the rock is going to deform in different ways. It may flow, it may fold, fracture, or it may fault. When you have stress being applied equally or uniformly in all directions, we call it confining pressure. And this does not change the shape or orientation of that rock. When we have a situation where stress is different in different directions, we're going to use the term differential stress. Three types of differential stress that we've talked about before are compressional, tensional, and shear. With compressional stress, the rock body gets squeezed, and so we get a shortening in the direction of stress. And I'm sorry, this would be this picture here, shortening in the direction of stress and elongation in the direction opposite the stress. Tensional stress is where the rock is being pulled apart. So you get a thinning in the direction of the tension. You get a stretching in the direction of the tension and a thinning perpendicular. Shear stress is produced when there is slippage between the layers, and so it is simply sliding past in opposite directions. And this top figure here is showing stress equal in all directions, and that is what is referred to as confining pressure. So strain is the term that we're going to use to describe a change in shape caused by the stress. So the stress in this example is shear, and in this one as well. And so the sliding past and the change in the overall shape then is the strain. So strained bodies lose their original configuration once deformed. When a stress is applied to a rock and then subsequently is released and the rock returns to its original size and shape, we call that elastic deformation. When stress is applied slowly over time, rocks will usually deform elastically. However, once the elastic limit or the strength of the rock is exceeded, it's going to either ductily deform or brittly deform. This is an example of ductal deformation. Once again, ductal deformation occurs deeper in the earth where the rocks are warm and under pressure. Several factors affect the strength of a rock. The first one we can talk about is temperature. When you have higher temperatures, they tend to deform ductally, as I mentioned previously, whereas colder rocks will tend to break in a brittle fashion. If you have confining pressure, that is the pressure that is equal in all direction, it makes them stronger and harder to break. And as a result, ductal deformation is generally what occurs. The rock type is also a factor. Crystalline, igneous, and some metamorphic rocks with minerals in them that have very strong chemical bonds generally will break in a brittle fashion. Whereas sedimentary and metamorphic rocks, where there are zones of weaknesses in the metamorphic rocks, they generally undergo ductal deformation. Another factor affecting the strength of a rock, time. If you apply force gradually over a long period of time, it tends to behave in a ductal fashion rather than a sudden force being applied. Think about pulling a piece of putty slowly apart. It will stretch and exhibit ductal deformation. However, if you take a piece of putty and tear it apart very quickly, it breaks in a brittle fashion. In the upper 10 kilometers of the crust is where rocks tend to break or behave in a brittle fashion. So you can get joints, which are simply fractures in the rock where no appreciable movement has occurred. Faults are also fractures in rocks, but they are moving relative to each other on either side of the fault. And then folds are bends in the rock where breaking has not occurred because the rock is under pressure and high temperature, so it behaves ductally. These examples are brittle behavior. This is ductal behavior. This is a nice example showing the three types of stress: compression, tension, and shear. And the result of applying that stress at shallow depths in the earth versus great depths. So at shallow depths, we get different types of faulting. We'll discuss more later. And at greater depths, we get folding or shearing and stretching. But regardless, it's a ductal flow rather than brittle flow, or brittle behavior more correctly. I want to introduce some geologic structures or rock structures now. The first one we're going to look at are folds. Folds are formed by compressional stress, where shortening and thickening of the crust occurs. There are different parts of the fold. We can identify the hinge line, the axial plane, and let's take a look at those. Here's the fold. The hinge line is this line right here. The plane is shown in blue, cutting through the area that is at its maximum bending point. On either side of the hinge line are the limbs. And this picture is simply showing once a fold is eroded, what it would look like. So this is the block diagram, what we see underground. At the surface here, we're going to call the map view. Two main types of folds: anticlines that are upfolded. They look like an A for anticline. The oldest rock layers in an anticline are in the center. The other major type of fold is a syncline. And that's a down warping or down folding. And the youngest rocks are in the center of a syncline. Anticlines and synclines can be symmetrical, meaning the limbs on either side of the axis are at the same angle or are symmetrical. Or they can be asymmetrical, where the limbs on one side of the axis of the fold are dipping at a different angle than the other side. And then we have special situations where we can get recumbent and overturned folds. If the plunge is not sitting level with the earth's surface and going into the earth, diving into the earth, we call that a plunging fold. The structure is an anticline, syncline, and overturned fold. These are the axes of the folds, And they have this one drawn here for you as well. This fold, the limbs on either side of the axis are dipping at the same angle. So we consider that a symmetrical fold. Here's an example of where this limb is dipping less than this limb, and so it's asymmetrical. And then the overturned is on its side. Notice the pattern on map view for a non-plunging fold. When these are eroded, you get this type of a pattern, a straight line pattern. If the fold is not sitting parallel with the Earth's surface, it is plunging into the Earth, and we can measure this plunge angle. The pattern exhibited on the map are not the straight lines that we saw in the previous slide, but you get a V or U-shaped pattern on the Earth's surface after the fold has been eroded. So that's how you're going to distinguish between a plunging fold and a non-plunging fold. Non-plunging, this is the pattern you get in map view. This is called map view at the top. This is the pattern you get in map view for a plunging fold. Plunging or non-plunging fold? See these V patterns here, that's telling us it's a plunging fold. I'm going to stop video one here for chapter 10 and continue on discussing domes and basins in video two. See you then.